people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect. The
yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Nepal, where the Supreme Court of the country, in a major setback to the embattled Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli, reinstated the functioning of the lower house of Nepal Parliament, which Oli had dissolved in December. The court termed his decision unconstitutional and asked members to resume Parliament in 13 days.
Pictures expressing gratification and celebration emerged in the Himalayan nation as soon as the Supreme Court hearing over a dozen petitions challenging the dissolution of parliament ruled against the Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli. Activists and commoners smeared vermilion and lit candles on streets after the apex court ruled Oli's move unconstitutional and ordered the winter session of the parliament to be convened in the next 13 days. Although a large section of Nepalese citizens feels vindicated by the ruling, the embattled Prime Minister is not appearing to be going down easily. His aide has hinted that he will be battling it out in the parliament. While the current combinations and inclinations don't give him much hope, some observers haven't ruled out the unexpected, considering the inconsistent past of Nepal politics. Of the 275 members in the lower house, Nepal Communist Party has 173. As per various reports, Oli has support of nearly 80 MPs, while the Dahal faction has a support of around 90 MPs. Nepali Congress and Janata Samajwadi Party have 63 and 32 members respectively. They are likely to support the Dahal faction, but any changes at the 11th hour can further deepen and prolong the crisis. However, with the kind of support the decision has garnered across Nepal, it would be nearly impossible for the opposing parties to express confidence in Oli's leadership. People have already hailed it as the country's victory.
सर्वोच्च अदालतले जुन एउटा जनताको पक्षमा फैसला गरेको छ जनताको पक्षमा निर्णय गरेको छ सर्वोच्च अदालत प्रति सम्मान गर्दै सम्पूर्ण नेपाली जनताको जनताले दिएको जुन जनमत थियो जनमतको विजय भएको दिन छ आज
The vote of confidence too is not going to be an easy task as the NCP will have to split legally in order to conduct voting in the manner it wants And it might take weeks to reach that decision. Commentators predict that political temperatures are just beginning to rise and the Nepal politics could witness several moments of heat and intensity before the crisis really ends. They have also cautioned the media to be restrained in its predictions, for nobody knows who their prime minister is going to be in just weeks from now.
We are now joined by Kosh Raj Koirala, a political analyst from Nepal's capital, Kathmandu, who will be providing us more insights into the story. How do you analyze the Supreme Court verdict and how, according to you, will it affect the political discourse of the country from here on?
Well, the Supreme Court's verdict that was issued on Tuesday has invalidated the move taken by the Prime Minister KP Oli to dissolve the parliament. And with this, the Prime Minister KP Oli will be like forced to resign from his position on moral ground. And now, as we can see already, the rival faction leaders of ruling Nepal Communist Party, they have already started lobbying and trying to solicit support of other political parties to form a coalition government. And it is yet to be seen how long will this take to form a new government, because the disputes, who is the authentic Nepal Communist Party is yet to be resolved, because Election Commission official, they say that it will take at least 2 more months to do that. The next step would be to what moves the rival factions will take. The first thing they have to be doing, they should be doing, is they have to be able to oust the Prime Minister KP Oli from their parliamentary party leader. And the rival factions is preparing to call the party's parliamentary party meeting. And that meeting will be taking decision topple Prime Minister KP Oli from that position. But until and unless Election Commission gives a verdict whether the party belongs to rival faction or Prime Minister KP Oli, and that will decide like how Nepal's political course will move ahead. But for now, it is not very certain like how this political equation will be formed in the days to come. So we need to still see, like we need to be waiting for the result of Election Commission.
Do you think there are chances of reconciliation, or the rival faction will go ahead with replacing Oli with a new leader?
Yes, there are some leaders already working for the reconciliation. For example, the party's vice chairman Bamdeep Gautam, he actually did not join any of the factions of the party, and he always advocated for kind of reconciliation, and he said that he would work for the party unity. And he's also gaining support from a large number of party leaders across the country, because they know that if there is no reconciliation, if the party is divided again, then they will have to lose the election. Like, election is just now 2 years away, if that happens on a regular basis. So if you look at the speech, the rhetorics that the leaders are actually the remarks they are making.
Moving on, while India's peace and diplomatic endeavors have received praise from around the world, its efforts in the neighborhood too are nothing short of remarkable. First, New Delhi called a truce with Beijing, and now in a rare move, it has brought Pakistan to the negotiating table. India and Pakistan have agreed to observe ceasefire along the LOC. Experts say the first joint statement in years that focused at restoring peace in the region could herald a new beginning in Indo-Pak bilateral ties.
In what has been referred to as a shot in the arm to the months of back-channel diplomacy, Indian Army and Pakistan Army will be observing the 2003 ceasefire agreement between the two countries. While it has surprised analysts and observers, the two sides said they were consistently working to attain such a situation. The development becomes more pertinent, for it comes at the heels of thousands of stepped-up violations recorded post India's move of amending Article 370 that provided Jammu and Kashmir a special status. Only a few days ago, New Delhi sustained talks with Chinese counterparts fructified, with both sides disengaging from the flashpoints in Ladakh.
India desires normal neighborly relations with Pakistan. We have always maintained that we are committed to addressing issues, if any, in a peaceful and bilateral manner. On key issues, our position remains unchanged.
The government of India has, however, maintained that there will be no let-up in the counter-insurgency and counter-terrorism operations. White House congratulated both sides for stepping forward for peace. The statement called it a step towards a more stable South Asia. Indian residents who live nearby the 776-kilometer line of control and have been the prime victims of all type of provocations have hailed the agreement.
Border ke log tang the, sab log tang the. Isliye hum apni is government ko zyada hi mubarak ho jinhone border ka ye maaz toda, Hindustan Pakistan ka toda hai. लोग आराम करेंगे और अपनी नींद से जिएंगे।
The region of Kashmir, which lawfully acceded to India in 1947, has been claimed by Pakistan for its Muslim majority. It continues to rule a significant portion of the region it illegally occupied through an aggressive mercenary campaign in 1947. The two sides have also had three battles for the region. When Pakistan failed in challenging India through military might, it resorted to proxy warfare under which it has been infiltrating terrorists across the Indian border. To facilitate their movement, the Pakistan Army constantly violates the ceasefire agreement. India has reported several uniformed men and civilian deaths due to these violations. The exercise, however, lately started appearing never ending as India too has been assertively responding to all provocations. Observers say that ceasefire is and should be the only option two sides be sticking to in order to move towards a more peaceful and stable future.
Moving on. In what appears to be an ambitious move, Pakistan is emulating Western countries to control the crime rate in its largest city of Karachi. It is introducing skating police to prevent broad daylight theft and harassment on teeming city streets. But considering the crumbling road infrastructure and the nature of crimes that are reported in the city, the prospects of this Western model succeeding in Pakistan are highly unlikely.
Gliding in a circle with weapons, this 20-member unit made up of 10 men and 10 women is being trained for a specific purpose, to contain a deeply entrenched and swiftly expanding crime culture in the city. The authorities say their prime targets will be perpetrators committing theft of valuable, including mobile phones, motorbikes and car. The number of such crimes was averaged 18,000 per year until 2019. The situation has recorded a slight improvement since then, but not enough to make citizens feel safe. Dubbed as Mega City, Karachi continues to find itself among the most unsafe areas on the planet, where both locals and tourists suffer equally at the hands of criminals. Authorities are confident that they can bring the situation under control with innovative measures like policing on skates.
मैं ये फील हुआ कि कराची में स्ट्रीट क्राइम की वारदातें रोकने के लिए we need to come up with some innovative approach. हमने एनालाइज किया, हमने ये देखा कि कुछ स्पॉट्स हैं जहाँ पर ज़्यादा इंसिडेंट्स होते हैं, से फॉर एग्ज़ाम्पल मोबाइल स्नैचिंग के. तो और दूसरा ये कि हमने ये भी देखा कि अक्सर मोटरसाइकिल्स पे होते हैं लोग जो कि जिनके लिए भागना आसान होता है. मोबाइल व्हीकल पर जो टीम होती है उसके लिए एट टाइम्स उनको चेस करना थोड़ा डिफ़िकल्ट होता है.
While some have hailed the decision as innovative and a potential game changer, a large number of residents are skeptical, raising doubts if poor road infrastructure of the city will be conducive for such endeavors. Although police have admitted that this team could not be deployed across Karachi due to uneven roads and footpaths, locals argue that most of the crimes are committed in those areas.
स्ट्रीट क्राइम के अलावा दूसरा एक अक्सर शिकायत होती है पब्लिक प्लेसेस में ख्वातीन को हैरास करने की, तो उसमें ये लोग काफ़ी रेलेवेंट होंगे। तो इनिशियली हम ये दो एरियाज़ फोकस करेंगे और उसके बाद फिर एज़ वी मूव ऑन उसके हिसाब से हम अडेप्ट करेंगे। हमने जगह आइडेंटिफाई की हैं दोनों हवाले से, स्ट्रीट क्राइम के हवाले से भी और ये जो हैरासमेंट की शिकायत आती हैं जहाँ पर फैमिलीज के साथ, तो वहाँ पर हम लोग उनको
Observers are of the view that stepping up surveillance, investigation and conviction rate should be on to-do list of the authorities. Not just Karachi, but Pakistan's overall conviction rate is below 9%, one of the worst in the world. Systematic flaws have been blamed time and again by the observers, but the government has not come up with anything substantial to deter criminals. So, it is apparent from the reports that it is not the innovating policing what city needs, but a comprehensive overhaul of the system which has done nothing but embolden the crime.
Moving on, be it providing basic amenities to its people or fulfilling their rightful demands, the government of illegally occupied POK, which works in cahoots with Islamabad, has always lagged behind. It is only concerned with filling its own coffers rather than doing something for the betterment of its people. As a result, time and again, people have to come on streets to demand their rights. Presently, the teachers in POK are protesting against the exploitation they are facing at the hands of corrupt administration.
Hundreds of teachers who have been protesting for weeks in Muzaffarabad city of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir have put the government on notice. They say the administration has not been considering their demands of salary hike and upgradation seriously, and the time has come to take their movement one step forward. Pen down strikes, blockading of major roads and highways and a sweeping boycott of all the responsibilities assigned to them is the blueprint.
हम सिर्फ स्कूल नहीं बंद करेंगे, सिर्फ तदरीसी बायकॉट नहीं करेंगे, बल्कि जब हम निकल आएंगे तो ये सड़कें ब्लॉक हो जाएंगी, सड़कें बंद हो जाएंगी, फिर हुकूमत के लिए भागने का कोई रास्ता नहीं होगा। असातिज़ा की से ये गुजारिश करता हूं कि आज के इस जलसे के बाद कोई भी हुकूमती ड्यूटी आती है, बोर्ड की ड्यूटी आती है, इलेक्शन की ड्यूटी आती है, उससे बायकॉट किया जाए। जो सरदार सज्जाद हमें हुक्म देंगे हम उस पर लबैक कहेंगे, लेकिन सज्जाद साहब हम ये उस वक्त तक ड्यूटियां नहीं देंगे, स्कूलों में नहीं जाएंगे, तदरीस नहीं करेंगे जब तक नोटिफिकेशन आपको नहीं मिल जाता।
It's been around 2 months since the teachers took the call of taking to the streets after the government kept ignoring their demands, but the authorities are yet to respond. Teachers accuse the government of misleading them and lying to them. They say the promises made by the ministers have never materialized. Now they have vowed not to retract without a permanent solution.
कि हम उस वक्त तक वापस नहीं जाएंगे जब तक हम अपना हर लेके नहीं लेके रहेंगे। ये कोई हमारा नाजायज मुतालबा नहीं है, बल्कि हम अपने जायज हुकूक के लिए इन लोगों ने हमें मजबूर किया तो हम घरों से निकले हैं।
टीचर्स इन POK से दे वर्क ओवर टाइम टू इंश्योर द सक्सेस ऑफ देयर स्टूडेंट्स, and this is despite the negligible support they receive from Islamabad. But they cannot be taken for granted. Pakistan, which has been drumming around publicizing itself, citing Kashmir's welfare as its top priority, has been acutely discriminatory in the real world. While the Imran Khan government has sanctioned all allowance, hikes and upgradations in the rest of Pakistan, the teachers in POK are struggling every day.
हम बादशाह बनाने वाले हैं और बादशाहों को खाक चटवाने वाले भी हैं। अगर आपने असाध्य के जाने हुकूक न दिए तो मैं समझता हूं कि आपको परेशानी होगी, आप अपने जनरल इलेक्शन को भूल जाएंगे। असाध्य बहुत मजबूर और परेशानी में, हजारों रुपए खर्च करके तावर से भिम्बर तक बाघ से कश्मीर के सारे खितों से सारे अजरा से यहाँ आपके पास आए हैं कि आप हमारे वजीर आजम हैं, हम किसी और से बात नहीं कर सकते, असाध्य को उनके हकूक दें।
The government has not just been apathetic to their demands, but it has resorted to punitive measures to resist their movement. The police had baton charged them and lobbed tear gas shells to disperse a rally they carried out a few days ago.
Moving on to India, which is a home to various classical dance forms, most of which have origins in ancient temples and scriptures. All the Indian classical dance forms from different states of the country quintessentially highlight the traditional legacy of India. This week, we take a glance at Khajuraho Dance Festival that was recently organized in India's Madhya Pradesh state to show its vivacious culture and talent.
Khajuraho is one of the most famous temple sites in India. The temples have an intriguing and awe-inspiring association with various classical dance forms. The temples are popular for their Nagara-style architecture and erotic sculptures on their walls. Recently, the Khajuraho Dance Festival, which is famous across the world for its breathtaking architectural backdrop, was held inside the temple complex. Artists dressed in traditional colorful costumes performed the Indian classical dance form of Bharatanatyam in the backdrop of the temple. The dance recitals highlighted the essence of India's cultural heritage and left the visitors spellbound.
ये हमारा सपना था यहाँ पे परफॉर्म करना। ये साइट इतना सुंदर है और इसकी सुंदरता में हमने बस कुछ नृत्य की कुछ चीज़ें ऐड करने की कोशिश करी हैं ताकि हम इस वातावरण को और भी सुंदर बना सकें। तो हमारे लिए तो ये बहुत ही बड़ी बात थी कि हम यहाँ पे हमने अपनी डांस प्रस्तुति पेश की।
द वीक लॉन्ग फेस्टिवल अलाउज द बडिंग इंडियन आर्टिस्ट टू शोकेस देयर टैलेंट। It helps dancers to get trained under different gurus from different parts of the globe, besides getting to interact, improvise and learn from each other.
हम लोग खजुराहो नृत्य उत्सव में पहली बार आ रहे हैं और यहाँ बहुत ही कला से घिरा हुआ ये स्थल है, तो हमें बहुत ही आनंद आ रहा है यहाँ पर, क्योंकि हम खुद कला से इतने जुड़े हुए हैं, तो एक ऐसा जगह देखकर जहाँ पे हर तरफ सिर्फ कला ही कला है, तो हमें बहुत खुशी हो रही है।
The festival also features a small fair and folk and tribal music of the region. It also displays the richness of Indian classical dance styles, including Odissi, Kathak, Bharatanatyam, Manipuri, Kathakali, and many more. Such festivals represent the culture and traditional heritage of the country.
The UNESCO World Heritage Site Khajuraho is a small town having a group of monuments and Hindu and Jain temples from 9th century. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.